Topical questions. Question number one, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what flexibility will be afforded to the installation of interlinked fire alarms in light of recent reports about the available funding for low-income households.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Thank you. Flexibility is built into the existing legislation through a provision setting out that the work should be done within such period as is reasonable in all of the circumstances. So this allows flexibility for homeowners who are unable to install alarms by the 1st of February 2022. Homeowners are generally responsible for paying for works to protect their property. However, in recognition that some may not be able to meet the cost of fitting the necessary alarms, we provided additional funding of £500,000 to Care and Repair Scotland to help older and disabled people. This was in addition to the £1 million funding to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service for their Home Fire Safety Visit programme to install alarms for those owner-occupiers who are assessed as being at highest risk from fire. Furthermore, our £50 million loan funding to social landlords has enabled them to fit compliant alarms to the new standard by next year.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer? But I wonder, can she define as what is a reasonable period and what is the cut-off date when the law will be enforced so that people can have certainty when this work needs to be done rather than just some kind of vague, reasonable time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, a reasonable period is something that's quite often used within legislation. So it's not defined as a certain number of weeks or a certain number of months. It just means a reasonable period of time for someone to get the system installed, because we do understand that there have been some supply issues around the supply of the fire alarm systems. We recognise that. So that is why we're prepared to give people that reasonable period in order that they can have a bit of breathing space should they be finding it difficult either to get their hands on the device or indeed get it fitted. And as I've set out in my initial answer, there is support available to those who require assistance in order to do that.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I push the Cabinet Secretary on this? There is going to be issues around house insurance if these alarms are not fitted at the appropriate time. So what conversations has the Cabinet Secretary had with house insurance in regard to whether that policy will be valid or not? And at what point will they decide that the date has become reasonable or not? There must be at some point a date fixed by government, or are we simply not willing to make that decision?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to Jeremy Balfour that we have not said in any way that this should be taken into account by those insurance companies. Insurance policies are obviously a matter between the insurance company and those holding the insurance policy, but we've never specified or said that this should be included within it. As I said in my original answer, the legislation provides the flexibility for work to be completed within a reasonable period, taking into account individual circumstances. I think that is a reasonable position. I mean, at the end of the day, this is about getting the message across to people that we want them to install these devices because it improves the fire safety within their homes. Of course, this originated out of the Grenfell tragedy. So it is important that we all give a message to homeowners that this is an important thing that they should do as quickly as possible.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I absolutely accept the necessity of people being safe. However, with the current pressures of Omicron, which is very distracting for people just now, quite rightly, and the rising cost of energy, can I say I welcome flexibility in the deadline, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary will take into account these other pressures on households just now, quite apart from obtaining the devices and having them installed.
Cabinet Secretary.
Christine Graham makes a reasonable point. People are understandably concerned about having the necessary alarms fitted by the deadline of the 1st of February. And I do understand the current challenges with living costs and COVID, as the member pointed out. So that's why I do want to emphasise that the legislation does provide that flexibility. And careful consideration is needed to balance the risks associated with even further delays of the legislation, which I'm not keen on, because at the end of the day, this is about improving fire safety. One death from a fire in Scotland's homes is one too many. So this is important that we give a message that people should prioritise making this investment. And of course, we have the supports available for people who will struggle with that.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, President Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has alluded to this, but colleagues in local government have told me that deliveries of orders of the interlinked alarms are being delayed, and that's in part due to the global semiconductor shortage, but also because of the disruption trade due to the pandemic. And in short, there's not enough to go around. What can the Cabinet Secretary say about what flexibility there is? Spoken about a reasonable allowance, but people are worried about breaking the law after the 1st of February. And what more consideration is the Cabinet Secretary given to a fixed date delay to the introduction of this legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say first of all that, of course, I'm aware that some manufacturers are facing supply issues, with particularly with imported components. Some manufacturers do have stock availability, and specialist retailers are also able to meet demand subject to logistical challenges. Now, my officials are in discussion with manufacturers to establish when supply issues are likely to be resolved more generally. But that's why, as I've said in the previous two answers, that we are giving that level of flexibility. It is important that people get these devices installed as quickly as they can, because it improves the safety of them and others within the home. But we do recognise, because of these challenges, that people need a bit of flexibility, and that's why we're giving that reasonable time frame for people to comply with the law.
Question number two, Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take in response to the British Academy of Audiology report on NHS Lothian's paediatric audiology services, which was requested by NHS Lothian following a review by the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Last week I made clear my views of the unacceptable failures highlighted by the British Academy of Audiology report into the provision of paediatric audiology in NHS Lothian. Our priority is to restore and rebuild confidence, ensure support is provided to those affected by the situation in Lothian, and to ensure this is not repeated for any other family. In response to these ongoing issues, NHS Lothian has been escalated to Stage 3 of the NHS Board Performance Escalation Framework for paediatric audiology performance and service delivery. Yesterday I met again with the board leadership team. We'll work in partnership with the board to develop a formal recovery plan. We agree with the BEA's recommendation to share this report more widely for greater learning in Scotland and across the UK. It is necessary a response to the findings and the concerns raised assure children and their families across Scotland that their child is getting the best possible audiology care. For all these reasons, I'll be writing to health boards to seek assurance on quality of care.
Fiona Hislop.
Six children could and should have received cochlear implantation surgery, but were missed in assessment and missed out on life-changing surgery. This was set out by NHS Lothian in a briefing I attended on Friday. Why should it have taken concerns been taken all the way to the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman for this failure of service to be identified? And what can the Cabinet Secretary do to ensure health boards take concerns seriously to assess if there are underlying systemic issues needing to be addressed so that problems years in the making, such as this, are identified promptly?
Cabinet Secretary.
Fiona Hislop is absolutely right to ask that question with the strength of feeling that she does. She asked me, I think if I got the phrasing of her question right, why should it have taken this complaint to have surfaced these issues? It should not have taken at complaint to have surfaced these issues. That is fundamentally the issue that the BAA brought forward in the report. There was a number of failures that, frankly, the BAA and their report brought to the attention of the Health Board. One of the most disturbing ones, I thought, was in some instances how dismissive of concerns and complaints those involved in that department were when parents came asking, concerned about their own children. So in relation to what will be done next, as I say, there will be a formal recovery plan. It will look at the very issue that Fiona Hislop raises and all of the issues that are raised by the various different reviews, including the BAA review.
Fiona Hislop.
One of the concerns about how this service had been operating was that it was not a regulated statutory service and all training was in-house, which entrenched inadequate observational assessments for young children. What can be done to ensure this is not happening elsewhere in the health service? And will the Cabinet Secretary action the call on this from the Deaf Society and other recommendations they are making? And finally, and most importantly, what support and assurances have been given to the children and families affected, and how can trust in this service be restored?
Cabinet Secretary.
There was three questions there, which I'll try to answer very quickly. I am meeting with the BAA and the National Deaf Children's Society, an organisation I've known for many years. I'm meeting with them later this week, and I've seen their recommendations that they have made, and will consider them with an absolutely open mind. I've already asked Lothian in terms of assurance if certain flanker lead flags were missed in the paediatric audiology department, how can they give me assurance that similar issues and complaints are, if they're being flagged in other departments, how are they being surfaced? I've also asked all health boards, and will ask them formally, but I've asked them informally to look at their own paediatric audiology departments to ensure that these same issues are not present there. In terms of the point that Fiona Hislop raises about regulation, it's a very good one. I'm having discussions with UK government about reform of professional healthcare regulation at the moment. I should say, even before this this report, I was in favour of looking at regulation for audiologists. This report has just strengthened that feeling.
Sue Webber.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The shocking review reveals the completely inadequate level of care given to youngsters with hearing difficulties in NHS Lothian. And many of the families deserve an explanation of how this scandal could happen. These critical failings have, sadly, a lifelong and significant impact on these young people and their families. And I am very pleased that NHS Lothian have accepted all of the recommendations from the audiology report. But I am concerned that this could happen elsewhere. And as stated, the National Deaf Children's Society is calling for an independent review of children's audiology services across Scotland, which is more than what the Cabinet Secretary has stated he's going to do today. So there is a real danger of many more deaf children not getting the quality of care unless this review is carried out across all of our services across Scotland. So when will such a review take place? And when? Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Sue Webber raises a number of important points. I should have said, and I omitted to say in my answer to Fiona Hislop, that the NHS Lothian did issue letters to the affected families last week, and measures are in place to identify any young child whose cases may require further clinical review, and also there is a helpline available too. But I have asked that NHS Lothian keep close to those families that have been affected. In terms of the broader point, I will meet with the National Deaf Children's Society later this week. What I would say to Ms Webber is that I would like health boards to look at their own paediatric audiology departments, thoroughly examine and explore if any of the issues that were raised by the BAA report are also present in their own health boards. If I find that any of those issues are more widespread, any suggestion that they're more widespread, then of course an independent review might be the appropriate thing to do. But what I wouldn't do is rush into that before I let the health boards do the work they'll do. But it will be done at pace, and Ms Webber is absolutely right to raise the concern that this could be more widespread than just NHS Lothian. But that is what I am exploring and examining. I'm happy to give all members that have expressed an interest in this an update when that review is complete.
And Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I associate myself with the tenor and remarks from Fiona Hislop, because I too attended the briefing on Friday. Can I also ask further in terms of the welcome points from the Cabinet Secretary that this clearly goes beyond just the technical application of a test. There's clearly fundamental problems with the culture in this unit, as identified in Section 4 of the audit report. So can I ask what is going to be done to tackle that culture? Secondly, on the red flags, does he think that he needs to go further than simply ask that question? And do other areas of practice not subject to statutory regulation need to be examined more fully? And finally, can I ask, these children who have had life-altering consequences from this failure, Will the government examine putting together a compensation process so those families don't have to go to court to get the support and financial support that they need for their children and their ongoing needs through the rest of their lives?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Daniel Johnson for the questions and the manner in which he asked them. In terms of the culture there, I will say two things. One, there are HR processes which NHS Lothian are taking forward. I wouldn't comment on them, and he wouldn't expect me to comment on those individual HR processes. But he is also right to say that the BAA and their recommendations recommend changes in terms of culture and practice, and NHS Lothian have had no hesitation in accepting those. But I will stress the points that he makes about culture when I meet with NHS Lothian next, which is very, very regularly. In terms of the points on regulation, I don't disagree with him. As I said to Fiona Hislop, I'm in discussions at the moment around what healthcare services specialists should be regulated that aren't, and how the regulation can be perhaps more streamlined. So those discussions are ongoing. Again, if he has particular concerns about a particular specialism, then of course he can furnish me details with that, and I'm happy to have those conversations. In relation to compensation, again, I will look at what Daniel Johnson has to say. There are processes whereby, of course, individuals can seek compensation from NHS health boards if they feel that there has been negligence. He is right, we would want that to be a lengthy process if there is fault. Clearly, again, this would be a matter between the health board and the families, but I will take on board what Daniel Johnson has said and give it some further consideration.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. There will be a very brief pause before the next item of business.